then Katrin Brüning-Gäse, giving the last talk of the symposium. She comes from a really interesting institute. In fact, she's directing and was instrumental in helping that place organized and set up in the way it is. It's an institute, Big F. It's a climate a research center, climate and biodiversity research center associated with the Senckenberg Museum. Many of you will know the Senckenberg Museum, Germany, sort of really preeminent natural history collection. And the state of Hesse made the decision, well, we really need to connect our museum up to some world-class biodiversity and global change science, because that's what drives the headlines these days and makes us relevant as a museum. So really, one of the few museums that I know that sort of bold and successfully went that route, and I think it's actually a real interesting example for us here at Yale and other places around the world to hopefully do similar steps. And so she's directing that institute and has been driving her own research group in the area of biodiversity and climate change for a long time. We've known each other for a long time, and it's really beautiful to have you here at Yale with us. Thanks, Katrin.
Thank you very much, Walter, for this very nice introduction, and thank you very much for the invitation and for the opportunity to listen to all the other very interesting talks. This is Hurricane Katrina, about 24 hours before it hit the coast of the United States and basically drowned New Orleans and made everybody aware that climate change with its associated extreme events, together with land use change, in this case the loss of mangroves, can have severe impact also for humans, on the economy, on social systems, and maybe even on political systems. However, at the end of the day, and as the last talk, we have to honestly ask ourselves if we have really the tools to predict or project what the impact of climate change and other global change factors is on biodiversity. So to focus my talk a little bit more, I want to address in my talk the questions: how do we predict the impact of global change on biodiversity on a global scale? And the large drivers have been mentioned before. It's climate change, land use change, exploitation, invasion of exotic species, and pollution. And starting right with climate change, there's a very good toolbox that people have used profoundly in projecting the impact of climate change on species distributions. Basically, you take observed records of a species, then build a model, in this case of the red-backed shrike, using precipitation and temperature as predictor variables, and then you use scenarios and changes in temperature and precipitation for the future and project the range into the future. And in this case, this model was based on observations in the 1970s and projected into 1990s, and it was predicted that the red-backed shrike would expand its range over the whole of Great Britain, including the Shetland Islands. And what makes this example so interesting is that we have, in fact, observed data for the species for 1990, and that's the special distribution of the red-backed shrike as it was actually observed in 1990. So it's a very sobering example of our ability to project ranges into the future. Not all of these models are so bad. In fact, most of them are not. But still, there's a lot of work to do and to improve our models and to make these projections better. And there's been already a lot of thought on what factors need to be considered. And this is the list that people have come up with. We have to consider land use change, obviously. The decline of the red-backed shrike in Great Britain is probably driven by changes in habitat. So multiple drivers and the interactions among those drivers are important. Biotic interactions need to be considered. Transient dynamics has to be considered. Dispersal, population dynamics, adaptation of species. A long list. And if you sit down and think about it a little bit more, we have to realize that these factors or mechanisms can be arranged along different spatial scales. So if we work from the community over the landscape, continental and global scale, many of these factors that are missing in the species distribution models are based here at the community scale. For example, habitat, population dynamics, biotic interactions are usually studied, investigated, thought to be important at the community scale. Then we have metapopulation dynamics and dispersal, thought to be important at the landscape scale, colonization, speciation, earth history at the large spatial scales. If we are now looking at our threats, global climate change is probably impacting ranges of species globally. So it's acting and impacting on a global scale. But many of the other threats impact populations at smaller spatial scales. Pollution is usually local unless we are dealing of lakes. Also, land use change is stepwise and usually local. Exotic species exploitation is also acting rather at the landscape, maybe continental scale. So the things that we look at in species distribution modeling and other modeling efforts, our response variable, the geographic range of species, is here at the continental or global scale. So what we basically investigate and what we have to ask ourselves, if processes that are acting at these small spatial scales, land use change, changes in ecological communities, habitat, basically reflect up to the geographic range of species and have an impact on the continental and global scale. Just to remind ourselves, most of the studies on land use are conducted at this landscape scale. Here, own studies in East Africa, here in Kakamega Forest, where we had plots, different sites of the forest, and had sites that were fragmented and others that were less fragmented, and an impact of local human disturbance in terms of selective logging. And we looked at the impact of those two factors, forest fragmentation and local disturbance, on the biodiversity of a whole range of species and on their associated ecosystem processes or functions like bees and pollination, birds and seed dispersal, and so on. And then we investigated for these five different groups here the impact of fragmentation and of logging on the community composition, in this case of bees, and on pollination. And the heavy errors point to highly significant connections. And it boils down that forest fragmentation is very much impacting the composition of ecological communities. The processes are rather influenced by selective logging. And sometimes we have a significant impact of the ecological community on the process, but that's rather rare. But basically, the main message is land use matters at this landscape scale. Now, how do we get land use in the species distribution models at a continental or larger scale? Now, here we build land use models, in this case, as an example, for the rock bunting in Europe, where we, on the first hand, had only climatic predictor variables, and here where we had not only climatic, but also land use predictor variables, and we investigated a lot of thought in picking for each species, specifically the fitting land use variables from using the broad categories of the Corine data set. And for the species, the model really got better. The blue points are correct predictions of the model, and what we reduced in the combined model, including land use, is the red errors, which is commission overprediction errors. So if we consider the habitat, the models get and can get, in some cases, much better. A second example that if we use habitat variables, in this case, tree species richness, we can get a much better understanding of what is happening in our communities. This is a map of species richness of birds in Africa with the high peaks in the tropical mountain areas. And here we have the species richness of the obligate frugivores, birds that are mainly eating fruits, and in comparison, a map of the species richness of the genus Ficus, the figs, which is a keystone genus for many frugivores, because it's supporting basically the frugivores also through the lean times and basically providing the stable diet of fruit throughout the year. We were asking ourselves which factors determine the species richness of frugivores in each grid cell, and we used a number of abiotic predictor variables like the altitudinal range of the grid cell, maximum temperature, precipitation, net primary production, and ecosystem diversity. And we set up these links a priori based on our expectation that, for example, NPP is influenced by temperature and precipitation as a hypothesis to test which of these factors influence frugivore species richness. And basically, and then did a path analysis and tested the significance of all these factors. And the best predictor of frugivore diversity was here precipitation. Now, when we put the diversity of ficus as an additional predictor variable into this path model, the impact on species richness of frugivores changes, and now the species richness of ficus is the best variable predicting it, and ficus itself is influenced by precipitation. And now the direct link between precipitation to frugivores is still significant, but much weaker. So basically, this is a way of getting a little bit more mechanistic understanding of what is determining species richness. It's obviously correlated with precipitation, but this path analysis suggests that the actual causal link is not direct, but indirect through the species richness of ficus. And this this improved understanding on the relationships can now be used in projections on species richness into the future. This is a map of Kenya, where we try to make projections on the impact of climate change on the species richness of birds. And we used a simple, basically multiple regression model, where we projected species richness into the future using only climatic predictor variables here to the left. And we have declines of species richness in the north and southeast and increases in central Kenya. And then we added to the model the species richness of trees as an additional predictor variable. And then we made two scenarios. First, we let the trees adjust immediately and instantly to climate change, basically projected the trees into the future as well. Or we left the trees as they were and had no change in tree species richness. And if we assume that trees respond immediately to climate change, the projection is identical to the projection without trees. Basically, these models, also for mathematical reasons, so models that just use abiotic predictor variables, not including anything like trees, basically assume that all the intermediate steps between the abiotic change event and the response of the birds, that they respond instantaneously, which is obviously not true if we're dealing with trees that need hundreds of years to grow. And if we, in this scenario, keep the trees as they are, the projections are completely different. We now predict decreases in species richness of birds in the whole of Kenya. So this basically demonstrates that we don't consider such transient dynamics and don't include the habitat or the trees in our models, our projections might be vastly wrong. So to summarize this part, it is possible to include habitat and biotic interactions in species distribution models, and it is also important because it definitely makes a difference. It can lead to vastly different results if we are not considering them. Next step, moving a little bit up the spatial scale to the landscape scale, and now ask whether dispersal might influence also our geographic distributions of animals and plants. And again, I'm starting at the landscape scale and at the scale where traditional studies on the effect of dispersal are conducted. And I'm asking here whether different habitat types like closed forest or agricultural land with very isolated trees, if these differences in habitat change the movement behavior of animals and change the dispersal kernel they generate for trees. We did this study with trumpeter hornbills in South Africa that are quite rightly sized to carry one of these new generation of GPS receivers, where you can basically locate the position of the bird with GPS quality and can lock the transmitter in a way that you can collect continuous or semi-continuous data. In this case, we collected a location data point every 15 minutes. And that's basically a day in the bird of the, a day in the, of the bird Ben, and he's starting out here in Oraibi Gorge Nature Reserve in early morning, sleeping here in the gorge, and it's leaving the gorge and flying through the sugarcane, spending here a quick stop over in a ficus tree. You can see the burned areas in the sugarcane until it reaches a little fragmented forest where it's spending about an hour and a half, turning back to a farm garden where it's feeding on often exotic fruit species, and then moving on through the landscape, spending another 2 hours or so in a next forest fragment, then here visiting the farm of Stuart and Benita Borchers, who became good friends of ours because the birds spend a lot of time in their farm, and in the afternoon, against evening, flew back to Oraibi Gorge. So with these new devices, we're able to get a completely new understanding on the movement behavior of animals in the landscape, and we can then use these data together with feeding trials, like we measure the gut passage time of the birds to understand the seed dispersal kernels that the birds are generating. Here is a picture of the landscape in which the birds are moving. Here's the scale, 10 kilometers, and each dark patch is a forest patch that the birds visited, and each red line is a connection where we have a time window where seed dispersal can occur. So basically all the red lines are giving us a picture of the functional connectivity of the landscape, and basically a picture of stepping stones and dispersal corridors in the landscape. The second thing that we can do is look at dispersal kernels in different habitat types. Here in forest, the distance seeds were moved, it's a unimodal distribution with a mean dispersal distance of about 160 meters. But in agricultural land, it's very different. We suddenly have a bimodal distribution. Seeds are transported either really short distances when the birds are moving in one of these farm gardens or forest fragments, or they are transported long distances, 512 meters on average, when obviously the mean distance between the different patches. So here in movement ecology and with these new technological advancements, we have the potential to get much better dispersal data than we dreamed of in the past. But does dispersal matter for geographic distributions? We investigated this with the Sylvia warblers, a very well-studied genus, Old World genus, where we have some species like Sylvia communis with huge breeding and wintering ranges, and other species like Sylvia sarda with very small breeding and wintering ranges. And what we looked at is range filling, so that's the relationship between the realized range and the potential range that can be calculated through species distribution modeling. Basically, all the area where the same vegetation, abiotic conditions consist as in the realized range. And from this quotient, we can see which factors might influence the realized range of a species. And as predictor variables, we used rather simple predictors, but they measure different biotic interactions and dispersal. For dispersal, we measured the wing pointedness of the birds. For competition, we measured the species richness of common genus in the same grid cell. We looked at phylogenetic age and the shift of the vegetation since the last glacial maximum to investigate if it matters, if species that had to move a long distance since the LGM had a lower range filling than species that basically didn't have to move very much. And first of all, range filling is quite variable. We had differences between 31% up to 91% range filling. And the best predictor variables was an interaction between dispersal and competition. Highest range filling was present in species that had good dispersal ability and few competitors in their potential range. And species that had either low dispersal ability or high dispersal ability but many competitors could fill their potential range only to a smaller degree. So obviously dispersal matters also at the geographic scale, also for the geographic ranges of species, and even for such animals like birds that are highly mobile. So to summarize this part, obviously these factors that operate at the community and landscape scale matter also for geographic distributions of animals and plants, and it is important to include them into the models because, as shown by these projections, if we are not including them, our projections can be really vastly wrong. And to put up just a little other story in addition, I mean, what we haven't talked about here very much is ecosystem services. However, with IPBES and other initiatives in this direction, it's obvious that biodiversity is only the first step, but that we have to look beyond biodiversity and also look at ecosystem functions and especially ecosystem services. However, for us biologists, it has been not easy to approach ecosystem services. And a nice framework where the variety of steps where biodiversity comes into the ecosystem service framework has been developed by Georgina Mays and collaborators. She pointed out that biodiversity matters for ecosystem services at different levels. It matters at the ecosystem process level, where biodiversity can act as a regulator of ecosystem processes, for example, in pollination. It matters as a final ecosystem service. For example, if we have trees and that produce apples for human consumption. And at a third step, biodiversity matters because it can be, in some circumstances, a good by itself that has an economical value by itself, here exemplified by the Mauritius kestrel, where people pay quite a lot of money to be able to see this bird or are willing to pay money to preserve the species. And I've been looking here at the direct value of biodiversity in a system where the link between biodiversity and ecosystem services is a little bit easier to draw than in many other systems. We are looking here at African savannas, where we know that climatic factors influence the vegetation, which is influencing the ungulates, the large predators, and the predators are attracting the tourists. So we have here a system where we have direct links between the abiotic factors of one hand, the biodiversity in the middle, and the tourists as ecosystem service at the end. I mean, again, this is a level where people have looked at ecosystem services at a community or landscape scale. Again, I'm asking, is it possible to draw these ecosystem services also to a larger macroecological scale? And we did this by doing a comparative analysis across multiple national parks in Africa, 63 in the meantime, where we compiled data on all these different factors, large mammal densities, tourist numbers, and then arranged them across a climatic gradient, and again did a path analysis to disentangle the different factors. And we get indeed very nice correlations in that rainfall is increasing the ungulate density, temperature is significantly decreasing it, the predators are most significantly influenced by the ungulate densities, less or not at all by temperature and rainfall, and the tourists are in fact significantly influenced by predator densities and also to some degree by temperature. If it's too hot, then there are fewer tourists. So we have here a nice system where we can plot ecosystem services in a more mechanistic way in space, and where we can also use now projections for future scenarios on rainfall and temperature to project it into the future. And with the difference that in many previous ecosystem service studies, it was basically just a mapping of ecosystem services in space using GIS approaches, whereas this is a step forward towards a more mechanistic approach. So to summarize, I hope I could demonstrate you that also for this global scale, it's important to understand the community processes that are underlying the global distributions, and that it is possible to include things like habitat or biotic interactions or dispersal or even ecosystem services in macroecological models and projections. Thank you for your attention.
Thanks so much, Katrin, for extending our discussions here to bring in species interactions and a more mechanistic thinking about some of those models. We have time for a few questions for Katrin. And actually, at that time, I also want to open up the floor. We have happily 5 or a little more minutes. If anything sort of came back to your mind about any of the talks earlier today, we're at the end of the symposium, and I'm happy to take some more general questions before we move on to a smaller discussion next door. Kaffee.
I guess this is just to you, most of the perhaps others, and maybe this is just usually idealistic, but in terms of all this land use change and the science skills of mapping that seems to be available from Landsat, and at the same time, we sort of this need to get somehow cross these scale barriers from, a lot of ecological processes acting at local scales within these landscapes, and then somehow trying to ask what the implications are at bigger scales. It seems like you have a really nice opportunity. And in some ways, instead of, I think against where you study, but instead of going to study sort of where we just happen to go, to kind of choose the studies in a sort of bigger, more holistic way, based on the maps that you guys have created in the remote sensing community, to then go ask these sort of she's asking, in specific places for specific reasons to try to really, in a bigger, more visionary way, try to bring together local community scale stuff with the and those mechanisms sort of see how it all scales up. Right? And so really getting it across many systems as opposed to just and perhaps guided by your maps.
What we try to we're loggerheads and foresters because the FAO wants to work with developing countries doing this the old school kind of systematic grid where they put, let's say, 5,000 plots out in the middle of the Congo forest and try to monitor carbon stock change in this very labor intensive, old school approach with fixed plots. And what we're saying is the dynamics, we see the dynamics, so why don't we do a more stratified approach where you target the dynamic and then you can, in a more efficient way, understand. It could be analogous with biodiversity too. We know where the change is occurring, so you can imagine these growing and shrinking strata of land dynamics and the biodiversity, whatever it is you measure, will correlate with in the absence of the presence of this disturbance. So, we think of it as a way to target field resources maybe in a more guided way based on disturbance. That was really interesting. The bird liked the exotic fruit trees, right? It looked like it was living in a natural environment and going to this food source that was anthropogenically provided. And you know, you'll find that that bird in a more natural environment may have a totally different life cycle or whatever. Day and day. So yeah, you partition the landscapes into more or less natural, more or less disturbance, and get it. I think that's what you're saying. Maybe. Not.
Any other more comments or questions? We covered a lot of ground yesterday and today. Even within every single talk, actually, we would cover a lot of ground by definition, given that we had the global charge here. Well, I'd like to thank you, from the Yale community, from YIPS, supporting us, attending, participating. Also from the folks from, I also want to thank the folks from out of town, from Stony Brook and New York and Boston. We had people come in from the surroundings to join us for this. So thanks for coming and participating. Thanks to Katrin for the final talk. Thanks to the speakers of this afternoon, and thanks to all speakers, in fact, for making the trip from Australia, from Europe, from Colorado. So really appreciate it. I'm not going to try and summarize or synthesize these 2 days. We, as I said, it was a broad spectrum of taxa, scales, ideas, approaches that we've had. But that was, in a way, the idea, to sort of show you the whole smorgasbord, if you will, the whole all the facets of how we can possibly get at tackling the geography of biodiversity and the threats of biodiversity in ideally great detail, but representatively across the whole globe. And I hope that the really excellent speakers that we've had, the real leaders in their respective fields that came to Yale, I hope that they brought across the challenge and the exciting opportunities and some pathways to potential solutions, and that you are with us excited about that as an important area of research here at Yale, with some of those global initiatives that are going on, and as a whole for us to educate ourselves and do more work in the future. So with that, let me thank Katrin, the speakers of this afternoon, and all of the speakers for coming together here at Yale.